But in a Christian way.
Right? In a Christian way, that's right. Good morning. Just a few announcements. Most of everything really is on the back page. If you'll just look at that, you can see that there are some birthdays that are pretty close, like Francis Bunch is tomorrow. Mike Beckman's today. Maybe that's the reason he's not here. We'll give him that. Okay. Mike Thomas coming up tomorrow?
No.
The next day. Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay. And looks like I'm going to go to the most recent ones is Daryl Richardson's is next on the 16th. So, and then we've got a couple of anniversaries down here, Marlon and Nita Butcher and Tommy and Kyra Davis later on this month. Anything else? I think sounds like the football feed went well. Yay. Had plenty of help?
Yes.
All right, good.
And
that's coming. In a week or two. Right? The hot water.
We hope and we pray.
And cross our fingers too. Okay. Greetings on this.
Wait.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Wait.
You got another announcement?
R2. Preacher has something to say.
Okay.
Preacher has something to say today. There's good news. A couple things. And I've been waiting to be able to announce this with great joy. Beginning the first week of November, our youth group is starting back up again, and we're really happy about that. I hope you'll be hearing more plans about that over the next week or two or three. And then, if you didn't notice, there was a trench dug out front all the way up to this southeast corner, which means that we now have water and sewage lines to this back corner, which means that the class that we have been trying to convert to a nursery extension since February or March is finally underway. And so we hope that by this week we'll have water into the building. It's to the building right now. And then we'll begin the work of reestablishing a sewer drain out so that we can put a stool and sink back in there so that we can then begin to finish the work. If you look, peek into the door out there, Mike Postlewaite has been in, has hung the frame for the drop ceiling. So now we can bring the electrician in that will put the new lighting in and add some new wiring for us. So we've kind of been stuck on high center for a while. But this last week or two, some things have really shifted that are allowing us to finally begin to move forward with some really, really important changes for our church that allow us to be much more the kind of church that we used to be and haven't been able to be for a long time. So it's incredibly important that we have this new, great, and it'll be wonderful, beautiful space for our nursery that allows us now to begin to work to reclaim our old nursery and do the work over there. But I'm really happy and excited to announce that our youth group, youth activities will begin work again, which now gives us a reason to begin to do some work upstairs in the education building because the youth space up there really took the hardest of the damage that had been done through the roofing floods. Mm-hmm. So anyway, progress, and it's great progress. It's the kind of progress I've been waiting to announce for a long, long time. And I'm very, very excited about that.
And if you see Ed down here drilling holes in walls, that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
What's that? That's right. Exactly. He's done a lot of work. Let's, I got to go back through this. Greetings on this 20th Sunday after Pentecost. We honor the power and the presence of God's Holy Spirit. Let us worship the Lord. Would you please stand? We're going to sing the introit number 657. This is the day. I think we do this twice.
Let us rejoice.
Churches where people clap when they sing that song.
Please remain standing and join me in the call to worship. God gives living water to those who are thirsty for righteousness.
God gives the bread of life to those hungry for grace.
God gives mercy to those who are enchained by unforgiveness. Let us give mercy as forgiveness. God and our brothers and sisters will give us grace as forgiveness too.
All right, if you'll remain standing, we're going to sing the hymn. Now, you know, they have me replace Ed and then they throw in, you're going to sing one song to a tune of another song. Okay, so turn your hymnal to 560. It's probably up here. But we're going to sing to the tune of the church's one foundation. We're going to try. Okay, here we go.
This is the third week. We've done this before.
Oh, yeah, if you've been here. Okay.
Please remain standing and join me in the affirmation of faith. It's the A Modern Affirmation on the screen behind me and also number 885 in your hymnals. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. As we prepare for our pastoral prayers we do each week, as we gather in the prayers, those that we are carrying for ourselves, the prayers that we carry on our hearts and minds for those that we love, those we have concerns about. I want to give thanks that Ty's in church today, and I saw a good happy face picture of him Friday night, which means that's victory, and winning feels a whole lot better than losing, doesn't it? I wouldn't normally do this, but I offer special prayers for those who are mourning on behalf of Texas yesterday, and I say a special blessing for those who are gloating this morning as OU fans. Stay humble. Stay humble. But in all seriousness, I was involved in some very acute pastoral care late last night. Some of you know that we did the funeral here a couple weeks back for Dorothy Miller, and her husband, Stan, was involved in a farm accident this week and was burned severely. His head, chest, arms, face, scalp from a radiator hose that exploded on a tractor he was working on. So he's in the burn unit at Baptist Hospital. Will be there for 3 to 4 weeks in recovery. And severe burns, especially in young people and older people, can be really complicated. So I ask that you would keep Stanley and his prayers and his family. We'll keep Jake Poole in our prayers, struggling a bit from a procedure that he had this week. I'll be stopping in to see him after church today. There's so much to be praying for these days. So much. Folks that are struggling, trapped in their own life circumstances. But there are folks who are also seeking hope and seeking a place to belong and a place to find grace. And we should be that kind of church that not just welcomes folks, but carries the grace of Christ out to the world. And let's do that today in our prayers, if you'll join me. Lord, each day that we come to worship, it seems that With every Sunday, new burdens have been added to the weight of our lives. Some new tragedy, whether public or private. Some new diagnosis. Some new loss. You see, anger and divisiveness continue to rise in our country, and rather than uniting us in our common struggles, we find ourselves as a country, even as churches, being split apart by opinions. Your truth came to heal, not to divide. There are great injustices in the world that we carry into each generation. Injustices that are harder and harder to resolve as they become deeper and deeper in the ways that they are embedded in our culture. But Lord, there is a grace that is greater than all of that. And you give it to us to be instruments of healing and instruments of peace. Lord, that we may be Christ for the world as Christ is for us. As we give thanks for all that we are thankful for, Lord, as we ask for all that we have need for, as we confess all that we need confess. Lord, let us join our voices now, our prayers together. As we join our voices saying the prayer that Christ, our great teacher, taught us to pray. As we say it together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Thank you. Well, Kim, you have the children's moment today. We invite you to come up. Ty, Amy. Yeah. Well, y'all pay attention from back there. This is where children belong.
He's kind of regretting this, I think. Good morning.
Pay attention.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Stop, Ed.
There was a little good morning. Okay, I hope I don't have to ramrod up here. Everybody's making them straighten up.
We just want candy.
Just want candy? Well, you have to wait. The wind blew me in the door of the church. How about you? Did you notice it was windy outside? Yeah, that means, I think they say rain is coming. Well, this morning, Pastor Mark is going to talk about forgiveness. And, you know, sometimes we do bad things. Like, Mom, you said Mom can have a cookie, and she says, we're about to have dinner, and so you need to wait. And then guess what? You sneak a cookie. Have you ever done that? My mom told you not to do something. This isn't confession up here. You don't have to... But sometimes we do, or sometimes we don't play well with others, and we don't do things that we should. And when we do this, it's called sin. And God asks Jesus we ask them for forgiveness. We ask God for forgiveness. I was a little distracted up here. Sorry, y'all. When we ask Jesus for forgiveness, he always washes away our sins and cleanses our heart. So is there anything that has ever happened at school or at home that kind of made you sad? Jacob's always good to you, and Caitlin, and everybody. No fight with your brothers or sisters. He's just not going to confess very much up here. Well, sometimes that happens. We play with someone, they're not very nice, they do things that they shouldn't. And when people make us sad, do you think God gets sad too? I think he is sad. I do think so, yeah. And God, it makes God sad, and God always chooses to forgive others. And we should do the same thing. We should always choose
to
forgive.
Even Steve?
Even Steve, yeah. Because God forgives. God forgives all of us.
Especially Steve.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Sometimes our friends do things that we don't like, and although these things make us sad, we can forgive them. And God says forgive over and over and over. So even if your brother and sister make you mad, or sometimes your parents make you mad, or sometimes your friends make you mad, you just have to forgive them, and you have to look the other way. Sometimes it's easier not to. And when you do forgive, it gives you peace. It makes you feel better. Peace, when you can't forgive someone, you're angry. And if you're angry, you're not happy. And so you need to forgive, and then you can be happy. So today when Pastor Mark talks, you need to be a good listener and open your heart to what he's going to say. So we'll bow our heads real quick. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can come together and learn about you. And we do pray that our hearts are open and receptive to the message he's going to give about forgiveness. Even when it's hard and even when we don't like it, sometimes we do feel better when the anger's gone and we find peace in you and forgiveness. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Can I pray? God, forgive Steve for being silly.
Amen.
It's hard to get up.
I need mic lessons. Okay.
Thank you.
Isn't it glorious when we get to hear someone like Nancy play a private concert to God and we get to listen in? What a great, great, glorious, glorious concert. You are such a gift and we are grateful.
Please stand as you are able as we read. I read the scripture for today. It comes from Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 24, and Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 22. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment." But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, "You fool," you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Matthew 18, verse 21. Then Peter came and said to him, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times." May God add a blessing to the hearing and understanding of this holy word. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you, Nancy. In that last reading, there are alternate translations in that last line where Jesus says, "Forgive 77 times." Other translations read 7 times 70, which would be 490, which is a little bit bigger than 77. We'll talk about that a little bit more in just a bit. For those that are new today, we are in our third week of preaching a series on forgiveness and the importance of its work and the effects of living lives in which we carry unforgiveness forward into our lives. So as we talk about learning the art and practice of forgiveness, learning can teach us a couple of things. One of the first most important lessons is as we step out in an act of humility, as we begin the work of forgiveness, we must remember our own shortcomings first. We have to remember the plank that's in our eye before we start picking at the little splinter that may be in someone else's eye. We have to remember our own shortcomings. We must remember the times when we ourselves have offended God, when we ourselves have offended others. It's an act of humility, self-reflection. It's especially true because we have such a great propensity, a great tendency to remain in a state of unforgiveness for others. Once we have been hurt, and we hold a place of unforgiveness against them, we tend to hold that against them for a long, long time, sometimes forever, sometimes even to the grave. So first, we step out as an act of humility. Second thing we do, forgiveness helps us regain the ability to hope for the best for the person that offended us, for the person that hurt us. Forgiveness helps us restore them to their full humanity. When somebody has hurt us, we no longer think of them as a full human. That person becomes that such and such, that so and so that did that to me. You've removed some of their humanity from them. Forgiveness makes them whole again, restores them to the fullness of their humanity. So you see them as a person, not just the person who hurt you. And lastly, forgiveness empowers us to pray for them, those who have hurt us. Forgiveness helps us pray for ourselves, that God's works of grace, God's will be done in not just their lives because they hurt us, but in our lives too because we need healing And we need to learn ourselves how not to hurt others. There's a great reality. It sounds confusing when I say the short little sentence at first. Hurt people hurt people. Hear what I'm saying? Hurt people hurt others. Broken people are always about the business of breaking others. We pray for ourselves because we have been hurt by people who hurt others. We pray for ourselves because we ourselves are those who have hurt others. We pray for God's works of grace and goodwill to be done in our lives and in the lives of others. So forgiveness is not just a practice. It's a practice that can become an art. It's an art that develops out of a long, continuous, repeated practice. What begins as raw, rudimentary efforts can become much more developed, much more refined with practice over time. Rembrandt. Some of you know the name Rembrandt, great 17th century Dutch painter, became an incredibly gifted artist and painter. His work hangs in museums and in private collections 300 years later, worth countless millions. But when Rembrandt was 3 years old, Rembrandt wasn't much better at painting than we were at 3 years of age. Probably couldn't have told our paintings apart. The difference between Rembrandt and us, by and large, is that he kept practicing. He kept practicing his art and went from a beginning painter with a passion for painting to a painter who learned enough to become a master painter whose creative gifts were renowned even in his lifetime, remain renowned 300 years later. Now, I'm not saying that we can become masters of forgiveness in the way that Rembrandt was a master of painting. No, actually, that's exactly what I'm saying. I'm saying exactly that, that we can become masters of forgiveness. All of us, each one of us, can become masters of forgiveness. Rembrandt became a master painter because he took lessons from master painters. And then he practiced. Rembrandt became a master painter who then gave lessons to other artists who, in time, became master painters themselves because they too practiced their art of painting. Any of us, in a similar way, can become masters of forgiveness because we also have a great master of forgiveness who still teaches us great lessons in the art of forgiveness. We too can become masters of forgiveness if we take lessons, the lessons that Jesus teaches us, and then practice. Jesus is the great master of forgiveness. Jesus is the great teacher of forgiveness. Jesus teaches us we can learn. We can develop the art of forgiveness if we learn our lessons well and if we practice. Ty, are you a better football player than you were 4 years ago? Have you practiced a little bit since then? Is there a little more to learn? How are you going to get there? Practice. It's the same way. None of us get better at anything unless we practice. Forgiveness is the same thing. The first passage that Nancy read today, Jesus, the master teacher, the master of forgiveness, is teaching us something about forgiveness early in the Sermon on the Mount. Now, many Christians think that the Sermon on the Mount is limited to those first few verses there in Matthew 4, what we call the Beatitudes. But actually, the Sermon on the Mount is much greater. All of chapter 5, all of chapter 6, and all the way through chapter 7 is the Sermon on the Mount. Sermon on the Mount is the consolidation of all of Jesus' teachings. It's comprised into a single discourse, a single teaching sermon. It comprises His entire ethic, His entire ethos, His way of thinking and living and acting and doing. It comprises His entire way teaches us how to live one's best life as a child of God, caring for, loving one's neighbor as oneself, learning to love God, learning to love ourselves as God loves us. If all you had was the Sermon on the Mount, you didn't have anything else in any of the four Gospels, didn't have any of the other 23 books of the New Testament. If all you had was the Sermon on the Mount, those three chapters, 5, 6, and 7, you would have all that you would need to be a good, solid Christian if all you did was practice the lessons that Jesus tries to teach us in what is His longest recorded sermon in Scripture. A passage that Nancy opened up with is the third teaching point. The third teaching point early in the sermon that contains the Beatitudes. He starts right off the bat with a biggie. He's teaching us about murder. He's inserting into his teachings about murder a lesson about forgiveness. Jesus was quite intentional. You have to assume that every time Jesus taught, he was being very intentional. Jesus is being quite intentional in his teachings here. He is intentionally equating physical murder with spiritual murder. In his eyes, in his teaching, there's no difference in terms of the consequences of how God looks at those two acts. Now, we know that in physical murder, someone literally kills someone else. One literally ends one's life in the way that Cain slew Abel. But in spiritual murder, one is metaphorically killing the other person. We've all heard this phrase. Someone may have said this to you. You may well have said this to someone else. You're dead to me. And you know what that means when somebody says that. I know you're still breathing. But it doesn't matter. You're dead to me. There's nothing about you that I want in my life anymore. You have no value. You have no meaning. You are dead to me. And you have murdered that relationship. Either way, physically or spiritually, murder has been committed. The relationship was killed. The relationship was murdered. The relationship ended violently. And Jesus makes it clear, those who murder in reality or in their hearts will be judged and find themselves in the danger of the fires of hell, Scripture says. Now look, I get it. We've all been hurt. And we've been hurt deeply, severely, and sometimes repeatedly. Anger, even rage is understandable as a reaction to mistreatment, particularly when it's deeply, deeply abusive. Revenge can be rationalized, perhaps even justified as an act of self-defense. But carrying anger and rage as unforgiveness over a long period of time has a cost to the one who's carrying the rage. And those who practice the art of unforgiveness become masters of unforgiveness. Every small slight, no matter how great or how small, becomes fuel that feeds their unforgiveness, and the weights and the chains of unforgiveness grow heavier and heavier each day. And the toxicity of that poisonous unforgiveness poisons more and more and more of your spirit every day. Unforgiveness is repressive. Unforgiveness is oppressive. Throughout this preaching series, I talk about the chains of unforgiveness, the chains The chains of unforgiveness. Unforgiveness is its own kind of prison. Unforgiveness binds us. In Luke 4:18, which is his first recorded sermon in the Gospel of Luke, standing in his home synagogue, reading out of the scroll of Isaiah, Jesus says these things about himself, identifying to the world for the first time how he sees his mission and ministry on earth. And this is all Jesus says. He says, I have come to heal the brokenhearted. I've come to restore sight to those who are blind. And I have come to set the prisoner and the oppressed free right here, right now. There are few chains that bind us. There are few chains that imprison us in the way that the chains of unforgiveness do. Unforgiveness binds, unforgiveness imprisons, unforgiveness oppresses, unforgiveness wraps us in chains that restrict and limit our freedom to love, to heal, to reconcile, and to redeem. Here now, though, we turn to scripture of a different sort to remind us about being a prisoner. For all you old hippies out there, many of you are familiar with the band The Eagles. They're still around. Mostly. They have a great song called Already Gone. It contains lines that could well have been written, especially for sermons like today. Well, I know it wasn't you that held me down. Heaven knows it wasn't you who set me free. So often it happens that we live our lives in chains and we never even know we have the key. Those lyrics could have been written about unforgiveness. Well, I know it wasn't you who held me down in the chains of unforgiveness. Heaven knows it wasn't you who set me free from those chains of unforgiveness. So often it happens that we live our lives in the chains of unforgiveness and we never even know we have the key to unlock those chains of unforgiveness. Jesus is the key that unlocks any and all chains of unforgiveness. Grace, amazing grace, unlocks the chains of unforgiveness. Last week, I talked about why forgiving and forgetting really doesn't work well for most of us. We can forgive if we work at it, especially as we practice the art of unforgiveness, but forgetting is almost impossible. But grace can unlock the chains of unforgiveness. Grace, the love of Jesus Christ, changes our relationship with what hurt us, and grace changes our relationship with whom it was that caused the hurt. Last week I said forgiveness is how we live in peace with what we cannot forget. Last week I said forgiveness is how we live in peace with what we should not forget. Arthur Lewis Smeads puts it this way. He says, forgiveness does not erase the bitter past. A healed memory is not a deleted memory. Instead, forgiving what we cannot forget creates a new way to remember. We change the memory of our past into a hope for our future. Lewis Smeads became a master of forgiveness because he was such a practitioner of the art of forgiveness. Lewis Smeads was one of the greatest students of the great master of forgiveness, Jesus Christ. Hear again what Lewis Smeads is teaching us about forgiveness. His lesson is grounded in the teachings of Jesus Christ about forgiveness. Forgiveness does not erase the bitter past. We all have a bitter past. A healed memory is not a deleted memory. We can't erase that memory the way we can a computer file. But instead, forgiving what we cannot forget creates a new way to remember that event. We change the memory of our past into a hope for our future. Forgiving creates a new way to remember. We remember now through a lens of healing. We're no longer confined to remember what happened through the lens of the pain and the shame and the consequences of what followed. Practicing the art of forgiveness means learning that forgiving is not the same as condoning. Practicing the art of forgiveness means learning that forgiveness does not always lead to reconciliation. Sometimes we cannot reconcile with a person because either that person has no interest in reconciling with us or simply because that person is dead. You can't reconcile with someone who's dead. I don't often share personal stories, these kind of personal stories, but this one is worth sharing. Susan's mother died a few years ago, and she was a practitioner, she was a master practitioner of the art of unforgiveness. The last prayer that was prayed over her in ICU before she became unconscious, dying a day or two later, was a prayer I prayed for her because she would not allow her own daughter, who's also a clergy person, to pray. Her mother held Susan in such a state of unforgiveness that she would not even allow her own daughter the grace of praying for her. For 4 years, Susan's mother held this over Susan, that at a restaurant one night, her mother, who smacked loudly when she ate, Susan simply said, "Mom, you're smacking. People can hear you eating. Would you just close your mouth?" She said, "I'll never forgive you for what you just said," and she didn't. For smacking. And she held that over her daughter, literally to her dying breath. On her dying bed, when her daughter could have offered her words of grace. When I asked Susan, "Do you want to pray for your mom?" her mom looked past Susan and said, "No, Mark, I want you to pray for me." That's a master of unforgiveness. It's not just the big things that we carry. It's the petty things that we add up over and over and over again. A 1 pound ball isn't very heavy. But when you've changed yourself to 1,000 1 pound balls, that's some heaviness. And that's what masters of unforgiveness do. Yeah, there's a few heavy ones in there. And there may be some 30, 40 pounders in there. But most of what they've accumulated and they chain themselves to are these little 1 pound, 2 pound balls, little things that they should have just moved forward, but they chain themselves to in unforgiveness. Becoming a practitioner of forgiveness helps us to learn that we no longer require or expect revenge or retribution. Becoming a practitioner of the art of forgiveness teaches us that we must not dismiss the consequences of what caused the unforgiveness, but we can change those consequences. And even if we cannot fully reconcile with a person who sinned against us or whom we sinned against, important healing can still occur as God helps us reconcile with the consequences, even if we can't reconcile with the person. A few weeks later, we held Susan's mother's funeral. She wanted to be buried in a small little country cemetery in North Louisiana where her parents were buried. She had been cremated. We called the local funeral home, and the local funeral home said, "Well, you can charge me $200 to come out and dig a 12 by 12 inch hole that's 2.5 feet deep, or you can just bring your own shovel and back and a hole digger and dig it yourself." So I did. One of my favorite pictures of me in active ministry is digging my own mother-in-law's grave. I got to bury my own mother-in-law, not out behind the barn. Susan wanted me to do the graveside service. I said no. you need to do the service. You need to say those words. In words that she had said over dozens of graves before then and has said since then, I watched her struggle, but say over her own mother as we buried her that afternoon at sunset. And I watched the tears of healing flow. It's not a perfect reconciliation because her mother never asked for forgiveness. But Susan did the work that she needed to do to reconcile. And she could walk away that day and leave the chains behind. That's what the work forgiveness can do. Lewis Meads says it this way: when you release the wrongdoer from the wrong, you cut out a malignant tumor out of your inner life. It continues echoing the lines of the Eagles: you set a prisoner free, but you discovered that the real prisoner was yourself. So how many times does it take to forgive? Jesus gives us this answer there in Matthew 18, 21. Actually, it's not the answer. He gives us the hint at the answer. In the translation that Nancy read, he said, Peter, not seven times, but 77 times. Other translations say seven times 70. What Jesus is saying is that it's not, Peter, that you have to forgive somebody 77 times or 490 times. You have to understand a little bit about how Jews and how numbers play themselves out in Judaism. The number seven is a holy number to the Jew. It means complete. It means perfect. Jesus is saying, Peter, you have to forgive somebody a perfect number of times, the complete number of times. He's taking the number seven and elevating it to 77, or taking the number seven and multiplying it times 70. But 490 doesn't mean 490. It means as many times as you have to forgive until you don't have to forgive anymore. What Jesus is saying is you forgive as many times as you have to forgive until all of the work of forgiveness is done. Until you no longer need to forgive, you keep forgiving every single time. As often as you need to forgive, you forgive until all the work is done. And when you have done the work, and when you no longer have to forgive, that's your number. Because the work has been completed. Forgiveness is God's invention for coming to terms with a world in which people are unfair to each other and hurt each other deeply. God began by forgiving us, and God invites us all to forgive each other as God forgives us. Pain caused by another is unfair. Yes. Pain caused by another is unjust. Absolutely. But God's grace is the answer and should be our response. God gives us the power. God gives us the grace to forgive, to heal what is unfair, to heal what is unjust. And in one of God's great ongoing miracles here on earth, there is always more grace than there is pain. There is always more grace than there is unfairness. There's always more grace than there is unjustness. There's always more grace than there is unforgiveness. There's always more grace than there is sin. And there's always, always, always more life than there is death. There is always, always, always more grace for forgiveness, more grace for us to use to forgive the other person than there can ever be unforgiveness that we can hold against them. Jesus is the master of forgiveness. Praise God. Forgive as Jesus forgives, and forgive as often as Jesus forgives, and then you too, can become a master of forgiveness. And just as Jesus did, you too, as a master of forgiveness, can change the world. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we give thanks for God's grace and mercy, as we do each and every week, we take a moment to give thanks for the ways in which you here and others continue to support the mission and ministry of this church as we participate in the work, the ongoing work of forgiveness and redemption and reconciliation. I was here for 3 hours yesterday evening working as pastoring, helping teach someone some of the art of forgiveness. The work that we do here doesn't just happen 8 to 5 on Monday through Fridays. And I know you're out there doing the same kind of work. But every gift that you give makes a difference and allows us to continue our work to be the presence of Christ on earth. That God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we sing about that in Thanksgiving every week.
Please stand for the doxology.
Forgiveness begins with changing our hearts. And I bet we're getting ready to sing about that. Just coincidentally.
I bet we do. In faith we sing, Change My Heart, O God, number 2152.
Thanks, Steve.
Sing out, please.
As we participate in our dismissal and our sending forth, it's hard at first, I get it, but it gets easier as we practice forgiveness. There's no reason to keep going through life chained to all of the weights of the hurts that you've carried. And some people carry those hurts for a long, long time. Jesus has the power to set you free, and He gives you the power to help others be free too. So go forth, as we say, leading grace, walking with integrity, serving with humility, knowing that we all are a forgiven people. And as we forgive, so should we forgive others.
Amen.
Thank you all who helped give such a great service today, Ed, Nancy.
I'm still Ed. Page, hymn number 389.
That's what the bulletin said.
That's right. So it has to be.
Thank you, Steve.
Freely, freely. 389.
Peace. If you haven't seen, we have risk for bad weather, severe weather coming in this evening, up to including hail and tornadoes. So keep an eye on the weather, keep an eye on watching, and just take care of yourselves and be safe tonight. Bless you.